So Leandros Magalaras is an associate professor in the School of Computer Science and Informatics of De Montfort University. He conducts research in the Cybersecurity Center at De Montfort. He was the director of the National Cybersecurity Authority of Greece from 2017, when the authority was initially established, until late 2019. He is a senior member of the IEEE and is an author of more than 150 papers in scientific magazines and conferences. Leandros, I'm inviting you to go ahead with your talk.
Yeah. I will try to share my screen. So hopefully you can see. Okay, can you see it now?
Yes, Leandros, yes.
Great. So first of all, I would like to continue the previous discussion. We are doing a similar investigation in DMU regarding the safety for automated driving with using trajectories of pedestrians. So I found very interesting the previous talk, and I think we're going to have a discussion with the previous presenter more thoroughly. So I am an associate professor in DMU. We're having a cybersecurity center, which is a center inside our Cyber Technology Institute. We are a center of excellence for teaching and research in cybersecurity, accredited by the National Cybersecurity Authority of the UK. And we do a lot of different things, different areas. We research different areas of cybersecurity and privacy in general. So my talk will be more general. And I will try to explain and present all the different aspects of security of our interconnected world. And in the end, by the end of the of my presentation, I will try to focus on two or three solutions we have also created in DMU. So to start with my presentation, we'll have to see what is the target environment that we're discussing about. We're talking about the Internet of Things and how edge computing is used in order to facilitate the communication and the services provided inside such an environment. So we have a complex environment, highly heterogeneous devices that are interconnected, highly dynamic environments and highly mobile devices. If you want to see the security and the privacy of this environment, you have to see it in all the stages. So we have to see, first of all, the human-centric security aspect. So the human can be an end user interacting with our system, or can be an administrator who have higher privileges and can control, let's say, the system. Then we have to see from the application and data-centric security. Here we talk about for security and privacy by design. How do we make sure that all the applications we are using are secure? Then we move to software and system-centric security. Again, we talk about software, but now we talk about the operating systems we are using in the different components of our environment and how we make sure that these operating systems are, first of all, working closely together and they can cooperate in a good way, and also they are secure. Then we move to the network-centric security. This is more obvious. We talk about increased access systems, honeypots, firewalls, routers, air gapping, how we split the network in small networks, VPNs, etc. But one important aspect that is closely related to phone computing is the device-centric security. We have different devices with different capabilities in terms of computational capabilities or memory capabilities that we cannot apply the same security measures or the same security applications. So we have to adapt them to their needs and also to the needs of the different applications we are running on top of them. Okay. So here is a snapshot of Google data centers and Google Edge nodes that exist right now. So we see that Google and other major service providers, they have some big, some huge data centers in some specific spaces in the globe, but they also use a lot of edge nodes where they cast some videos or some other applications that are mostly used by the people, by the users, in order to decrease the delay and increase the efficiency of the product that is given to the user. So what is about, what is this phone computing? Probably you have already heard it until now. So we talk about the three-tier architecture with the things and then devices in the lower tier, where we create some virtual clusters that are served by a fog node or different fog nodes that exist in the second tier, where we have the routers, some servers, and other components that can serve as fog nodes in this fog architecture. In the third tier, we have the well-known cloud compute, cloud centers and cloud computing, which the fog nodes are communicating with in order to retrieve more information and to also be able to offer their services. What are the characteristics of phone computing? We talk about low latency and location awareness. This fog architecture supports geographic distribution of the services and device mobility, so the end user can move around the globe and can be served from different phone nodes, since the phone nodes communicate one to the other. It offers higher capacity of processing, a higher number of nodes, wireless access to the architecture, and real time, it can accommodate real time applications in a better way. Of course, it also supports the heterogeneity of different devices. What is the key difference? We wanted to find the key difference between cloud computing and phone computing. In one sentence, we would say that cloud computing tries to optimize the resources globally, while phone computing is, let's say, a small cluster that tries to manage the local virtual cluster that is created under the fog node. So in this talk, we're going to discuss all the security and privacy issues that arise from phone computing. I have divided in some different categories, although many other categories exist. So I will talk about trust, authentication, secure communications, and users' privacy. And then we're going to see what are the malicious attacks that may happen in a fog environment, what are the countermeasures, and what are the some solutions and open research directions for everyone to work on. So when we talk about trust, how can we trust the fog node in order for it to give us some, to provide us some service? So the IoT devices should be able to validate whether these fog nodes, the fog nodes need to validate the IoT devices that are genuine. For example, they're not trying to create a lot of queries for, in order to launch a denial of service attack. But on the other hand, the IoT devices also need to validate that and verify that the fog nodes are secure that they communicate with, because they send to the fog nodes some data, some information that, that needs to be protected. Okay. So a big question here would be, how do we measure trust in a fog service environment, and how and what are the main attributes that define the trust of fog services? Another question would be, who will verify and monitor these attributes that are used to monitor trust? Because we talk about a high heterogeneous environment and high distributed environment, okay? So some solutions that could be used after they are adapted to this new environment is reputation-based algorithms that based on the on historical, on how these nodes were operated in the past, they can give them some marking or some value in order to be trusted in the future. A lot of algorithms exist in the literature about it. An important thing that needs to be incorporated when we talk about trust, especially in this Internet of Things phone computing environments, is the reliability of different devices. In general, when we talk about security, reliability is a part of security, although if we want to go in the past, reliability was the initial measure to the initial, idea that was used in order to measure how a device is functioning well or not. Also, there are SLAs that can be used in order to cover the legal, at least, aspect of the trust between the different nodes. Authentication. So we have the traditional authentication mechanisms that use certificates, public infrastructure, which are not very suitable for these environments due to the source constraints. At least they're not applicable to all the layers of the fog environment. maybe if we can offer this as a service, authentication as a service could help us in order to be more effective, maybe by creating some certifying authorities in the different layers, in order to be able to accommodate also the dynamic fault nodes and end users that are entering and leaving this network all the time. From the end user perspective, the important thing is to solve this complexity and efficiency problem of registration and re-authentication with the different applications he's using. And we're going to see in another slide a solution we have just proposed a couple of days before. Another aspect is secure communications. We have the communication between the constrained IoT devices and the fog nodes. We have the communication between the nodes themselves in the tier two. We have to reassure that we offer end-to-end security and maybe end-to-end privacy. Some solutions could include blockchain, at least for the fog nodes. And of course, we can also use some intrusive detection systems that can be used in order to find some that some nodes are not behaving according to what was expected. Here is an example of how we can build an intrusive detection system by retrieving raw data from the environment and creating, doing the pre-processing, the selection of features, the pre-processing, and then by using some data mining techniques, we can create some alerts that can be sent to the appropriate administration layer in order to spot and further investigate if there is actually a real malfunction in a place inside the system. Now, in terms of end users' privacy, here we have a lot of discussion that we have seen it in different areas like smart grids or smart cars or other all the other smart cities or environments we are seeing all the day, these days. Because fog nodes collect sensitive data that could set the identity, users of utilities like the smart grid, and of course the location of the user, which is the most important aspect of privacy, because this can be correlated with other information and reveal trajectory, habits, the friends, what the beliefs may be of the users. So this is very important to be protected. We have seen lately some publications that have managed to disclose, to show how information can be disclosed from smart meters reading that show this information can reveal when the house is empty or even what programs the users are seeing, which is very, very sensitive information. What are the solutions? They call the well-known anonymization of information or other aggregation of the information that is gathered from a different end nodes. Of course, there are the side channel attacks and how we can avoid them or how can we secure our systems against these side channel attacks. What are the major attacks in a fog-based IoT applications? We have the Sybil attacks, differential attacks, false data ejection, replay attacks, privacy attacks, impersonation or collusion attacks. I have some countermeasures here in this table, some of which can be applied as they are, or some of which must be adapted to fog computing. One big aspect of these attacks is the insider threat, which is from a malicious insider who is trying to take advantage of his privileges inside the system. Here we can use some profile, some behavioral profiling in order to see if the user is, for example, working as his contract says that he is about to work. So if he's collecting all the data that are useful for his work, or he's in his office in the hours that everyone is expecting him to be, etc. So here is a general overview of this insider threat aspect. We have the threats, which can be employees, contractors, trusted business partners that may use some data of the application in order to build some new applications, or we need to send the data there for some other reasons due to SLAs. What are the assets we need to protect? People, information, technology, and the facilities. What are the reasons, as we said, it's maybe accidental, sabotage, espionage, social engineering, so the user doesn't know that his account has been compromised and someone is using his privilege in order to attack the system. The effects can be from damage to reputation to theft of IP, which is very important aspect of security and all the damage to CIA, security, confidentiality, integrity, availability of the services offered by the organization. So what are the research challenges? According to a table we have created in one of our publications, which I have in the sources in the end of this talk. So we have malicious or malfunctioning fog nodes, the insider attack, as we said, a mutual authentication among nodes, which is very important and needs to be offered in an efficient way. Privacy preservation, for example, for WAF assisted phone computing, but for all the other aspects that phone computing can be applied. Forensics, we need to collect a lot of log data that from a large number of fog nodes, and how can we use them efficiently in order to see when the attack has been originated from. Authentication and key agreement in wireless runs, etc. We're going to see again the research challenges in another slide later. So what are the offered and the proposed authentication and privacy preserving schemes? I have created a table here with some schemes, state-of-the-art schemes that are proposed lately. We see that these schemes are applied in general for computing, or some of these are applied to specific aspects like vehicular crowd sensing or WAF or other applications. And they combine the cryptography and the security techniques we know, but then they adapt these solutions based on the requirements of phone computing. So this is some of the proposed, of the lately proposed schemes. In general, when we talk about privacy preservation, we have to talk about trajectory privacy, which is collected with location privacy, users privacy, the data privacy, differential privacy, and we have to have a holistic overview of the privacy issues that can emerge in such an environment when we build a, when we build a fog computing environment. And a special focus needs to be given to the access control mechanism we are using. And based on the work from Hang and Toll that was a couple of years ago, it has created a very good categorization of the access control models that can be applied to phone computing, which is discretionary, mandatory, role-based access control, attribute-based control, user control, reference monitoring access control, and proxy encryption models. Next slide. So we said that we need some secure and efficient authentication mechanisms. Recently, we have proposed a novel two-factor honey token authentication mechanism that you can find in this archive. We haven't published it yet. It's under review. So one authentication mechanism that is used usually is the two-factor authentication mechanism that can secure our application against an attack. It's based on the fact that except from the username and the password, the user must give a token that is sent to his mobile device. But we have seen lately a lot of attacks like SIM cloning and other attacks that can steal this code while sent to the mobile device. And for that reason, we have proposed a very efficient and very, according to my opinion, innovative solution, which is very, very simple to tell you the truth. So when the user registers in the system, it receives a number which is between 1 and n, and is a maximum number that says to him that this number is the correct token we are going to receive from now on. So the number can be 5, for example. After he enters the system and signs into the system, he will receive a number of tokens by mail or using a QR node or two QR codes. And all of them will be in the same message or in the same website, in the same page. And he knows that from this number of QR codes, only for him, only one of these is the correct based on the information he has received during the registration. All the other one-time password or the other tokens, and they are not one-time password anymore, all the other tokens, so that the QR codes are fake, and also they are honey codes. So if someone tries to manage to steal them during transmission and tries to put them in the application, the account is locked and everyone is informed that there is a leak somewhere that is very important and must be further investigated. Another important thing when we talk about security for fog computing is the certification of all the devices that are used in these environments, in these complex environments. And not only the devices, but also the applications, the services, the processes, anything that is used in this environment must be certified. For that reason, the European Union has decided to issue, to launch a certification framework for general ICT, digital Internet of Things, let's say, and has created a stakeholder certification, cybersecurity certification group. And they have already issued a first framework for the cloud. Probably they will continue with fog and other aspects of the ICT. I think that this is one of the major things that are happening now nowadays. This cybersecurity certification framework is based on risk-based analysis. We're going to see later how this risk-based analysis can be done. One very interesting work that I have found that is very latest is this FONAC Fog Node Audit and Certification Scheme. It's a semi-automated fog node certification scheme. For every node that is used inside this phone computing, there is a semi-automated audit mechanism that can be used in order to see if this device is working correctly. Based on these findings and having read this new ICT cybersecurity policy document, which I was co-leading actually with other two colleagues from IEEE, I think that inside you can find some very interesting information about the certification. Inside this policy document, we mentioned that an important aspect before launching any new certification scheme is to do some impact assessment of how this certification scheme will impact all the processes and the services that are provided. So how easily it can be adapted from the industries and the organizations. This certification must be lightweight in order to be applied to any end device, also cost effective, and must avoid excessive burden in order to be adopted. Also, it would be good to have some semi-automated procedures for cybersecurity that can assure the scalability of the process. And this was written before this FONAC semi-automated framework. And of course, one important thing is the lifetime of the certification. So if you issue a certification for a device or a process or anything, this cannot stay forever. It must be reissued every some months or some years, depending on the criticality of the application. All this certification is based on risk management. So risk can be is unpredictable and failure is inevitable. So we cannot exactly find the risks that we have in especially in such complex environments, but we try to map as better as possible our systems and find the risks in order to apply the correct security mechanisms and secure our systems. Another solution would be to create some maturity assessment frameworks for all the systems that can cover all the different systems. For example, we have issued one maturity assessment framework lately that was NIST directive tailored for all the critical infrastructures, but maybe a novel and another maturity assessment framework that could be tailored, would not be tailored to specific legislation, but can cover all the security requirements that are that come out of all the legislations, and not only legislations like GDPR and NIST, but all the needs that the organizations may have. Could be of, I think, a major innovation that can help organizations find their gaps and be more secure. So these are the obvious set issues that all of us and you can further investigate in phone computing, which are related to the dynamic nature of fog nodes, the malicious insider threats, the forensics, the trust, secure communications, and of course, some encryption mechanisms need to be in place in order for our system to be secure. So these are the sources I used for this presentation. I try to make it more general rather than focusing on a specific article in order to give you an overview of the security and privacy issues for phone computing and IoT. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer. This was my talk, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Leandros, for the excellent talk. I think we have time for one question, maybe. There is one question, Leandros. I'll just read that question out.
Yeah.
So the question is, will blockchain integration help in edge security?
Regarding blockchain, I have a lot of discussions with many scholars around, with many collaborators of mine. We have applied blockchain in different aspects of IoT ourselves, like WAF blockchain or smart grid. We have applied blockchain, but you can, according to my opinion, you cannot put blockchain in every end device. This is my opinion. You could apply blockchain in a higher level, maybe the fog nodes, which are not, which are smaller as compared to the fog devices. Yes, in fog nodes you could apply the blockchain. And in general, blockchain is not a panacea. You cannot apply it everywhere. Most of the time, you're going to cause problems rather than solve the problems you are trying to. This is my opinion.
Thank you, Leandros, for the excellent talk. Thanks for accepting the invite and talking at the event. Thanks a lot.
Thank you for inviting me.